Hi, this is live streamed. I've been told to tell you, and if you don't want to be in it, go and sit at the back. That's my instructions. I'm the first speaker. There are five of us, and I believe each of us will introduce themselves. My name is John Ralston Saul. I write books like Voltaire's Bastards, The Collapse of Globalism, and Conscious Civilization. Until a year or so ago, I was the elected international president of PEN, the original civil society organization, 1921, that works to keep writers, bloggers, everybody who talks and writes alive and get them out of prison. And I'm also now the co-chair, have been for a dozen years, of an institute called the Institute for Canadian Citizenship, which works on immigration and citizenship issues and how to get new citizens involved as fast as possible in society, in whatever, in as many political, social, and cultural ways. So yesterday, we had a session that I took part in which my job seems to be to start things off with generalities, since I'm supposed to be a philosopher, as opposed to a technical person. And I said yesterday at the beginning that technology has no ethical content or purpose whatsoever at all. The Romantic period denied that and got us into a lot of the trouble we're in today, because by being romantic and believing that technology had a purpose and had some ethical content in that purpose, what we did was leave a vacuum, and that vacuum was filled by governments, government security agencies, and commercial forces. They, in effect, and this is what I, whenever I come into a session, people are talking about the outcome, without saying it, the outcome of, 20 years of leaving a vacuum, and that vacuum being filled by real power, which is not romantic, and they therefore have an enormous advantage today, and every session I've heard is talking about how do you deal with the advantage that we've allowed them 20 years to get. How do you actually fight back against that? And certainly in PEN, on a daily basis, I think we're up to something like a third of our cases of people being killed or people in prison are internet cases. So it used to be that they arrested or hung Nobel Prize winners and well-known writers. Now it's the bloggers and so on who are among the principal victims. And I have to say that this problem, I mean, it's very important to just say these things. They're sort of banal and self-evident, but if you don't say the larger stuff, you get lost in the fighting back detail by detail. You have to do both. You have to understand the shape of what's happening. And I would say that from a historical point of view, that Western civilization, Western democracies, whatever they like to describe themselves as, are increasingly slipping back into a mindset which is essentially the mindset of the mid-19th century. So the ideas attached to freedom of expression, to power, to limitations, are closer and closer to concepts which were philosophically and politically familiar in the middle of the 19th century. And we're sort of, you know, rolling on as if we're going forward and we just have to fight off these various problems, whereas people like me are saying, we're not rolling forward, actually, the basic assumptions of government and corporations that we have today are very familiar. They belong in about 1870, 1880. And so the second point I want to make is that one of the problems of the first 20-odd years was this sort of idea of the borderless revolution of technology, which I'm all in favor of, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. However, what it did was it obscured, and I'm taking a little leap from what I said yesterday, it obscured a very basic idea, which is that 99% of people live somewhere and belong to a society. And those societies have power structures, legal structures, and protections in them. And those in the 21st century idea are supposed to be based on an idea, concept of legitimacy, and the legitimacy lies with the citizens. And it's the citizens who empower. I'm not being romantic. This is actually what the constitutions say, what the bills of rights, the charters of rights, and this is what international agreements say, that the legitimacy of security, of the commercial forces, of the governments, rises out of the citizenry. And the problem with the dream of the borderless technological world is it undermined the power of the citizen in their role as the source of legitimacy. And what's fascinating is that the citizens have always been the source of legitimacy. The mandate of heaven in China was all about the legitimacy given by the citizens to the emperor of China, and that when he didn't fulfill his job, the citizens had the right to overthrow him. It was a bit of a bloody mess, but they had that right. And we've always had, for example, through about 400 years in Europe, absolute monarchs and churches who tried to pretend that they were the source of legitimacy because of God or because of the grandfather of the king. But they knew they were fighting against something that went back thousands of years of the source of legitimacy. And what's happened today is that the churches and the kings have been replaced by the security agencies and the corporations. It's really historically not very complicated, unfortunately. And the security agencies in particular, certainly since the Twin Towers event, have been hiding behind the inevitability of technology as a way of justifying an increasing amount of power going to them. And I have to say, as a former president of Penn, that we've actually reached the stage, and again, many people have talked about pieces of this, we've actually reached a stage where it's incredibly difficult to communicate at an international level on serious issues. For example, China, where we have many people in prison and being beaten up and so on, it is incredibly difficult to have an international conversation about China without it being listen to. In fact, very often we're reduced to using fax machines. Not that fax machines can't be penetrated, but that if you do it, and you do it quite fast, and you're careful about the words you don't use, you can maybe get away with it to some extent. But so we've actually reached a stage where, in spite of very sophisticated encrypting systems, a lot of people are actually going backwards to the most rudimentary forms of communication as a way of escaping from the influence of both the corporations and the security agencies. So the other people in the panel I saw are going to give you some really interesting, fascinating, specific examples, which I'm looking forward to listening to. But I just want to add to that already all the studies we've done show that between 25 and 60% of writers, bloggers, writers, in democracies through to autocratic states, 25% is in the democracies, are self-censoring themselves because of what's happened in terms of the borderless internet. And I can promise you that for 6 years as president of Penn, I never wrote an email that wasn't censored by me. Otherwise, I couldn't do my job without risking the lives of people. And that's an astonishing situation to be in. One of the other interesting things to come out of all of this, I think, is something to do with the indirection of the communication systems, is that there was an old idea, which was that people in public life were supposed to have thick skins. And over the last 20 years, we've seen a return of the thin skin phenomenon among public officials. I've never seen so many presidents and prime ministers and CEOs whose skins are so thin. And it has something to do with the fact that there's a sort of sense of the indirection of the communications, which is making them lose the sense of just how tough you have to be in public life. So I think, quite simply, that there are many, many things that people are doing, but you have to also look at what are the central issues for major political campaigns inside countries and at the international level. And I actually think that one of the jobs of people like us is to ensure that in the next French presidential election, it's a bit late, but whatever election we're talking about, that we're actually not just talking among ourselves about technical possibilities, but actually going into the political parties and pushing this whole issue of freedom of expression and the problem of invasion of freedom of expression through technology, that we're pushing that to the top of the political agenda. Remember, there are, political parties go into elections with 100 or 200 things on their agenda. And I can promise you this issue isn't even on that list. And if it's not on that list, we're not going to get the kinds of reforms and changes that we require as citizens who are the source of legitimacy. Now, all of that's very negative, and I can't resist saying one positive thing. I mean, there are billions of positive things happening as a result of all of this. I said I'm co-chair of the Institute for Canadian Citizenship. The day that you're sworn in as a citizen at a big public ceremony, you are offered membership in something we have organized called the Cultural Access Pass, which means that that day you and your family for 12 months become members of the pass, which gives you free access to about 1,400 cultural institutions, museums, art galleries, everything, plus special prices on railways, plus seats in theaters and in operas and so on. All of this is only organizable because of the astonishing communication system which we run that goes along with this. So it would be very foolish to act as if everything is negative when we know enormous amounts of it are positive. And I think the last thing I would say is this, that having begun with this idea of the legitimacy lies with the citizens and it is not borderless, it is incredibly important, and I don't know how many of you are Europeans, it is incredibly important to realize, therefore, that it is deeply, deeply irresponsible to force people to hang around in Europe not as citizens. Or to put this the other way around, I, as a citizen, believe that I cannot afford to have people hanging around in poverty or rich, but without the helping carry the burden of citizenship. That the faster people become citizens, the faster they become involved in the political process, in the cultural process, in changing things, in being part of the debates. And it is really, really fascinating that Europe, after 75 years of every Western European country bringing in large number of immigrants every single year, that there is still not a single European country with an immigration policy. There is not a single European country with a Ministry of Citizenship and Immigration. They have junior ministries under the Ministry of the Interior, the police ministry. And therefore, third, there isn't a single European country with a proper civil service specialized in refugees, immigration, and citizenship. And you can see that. You want to know why people are getting in those boats? Go to the embassies in the Middle East, and you'll find that there's nobody in the European embassies who is actually responsible for this area. This is an enormous challenge. Technology can play an incredible role in helping with it. But the challenge, I think, the technical challenge, is that maybe it's my generation, technology is very complicated, but it doesn't encourage complexity. It doesn't encourage complex thought, complex ideas. It is complicated, but it is utilitarian. And the difficulty is, I think, when I look at all the arguments being made here, is how do you actually take technology into the world of philosophical and humanist complexity? That's a really complicated issue. It's completely different from the issue of how do you put specific policies and programs in place. It's how do you force technology to become the servant of philosophical, social, and humanist complexity. And that's where actually the answer to, the real answer to a lot of the problems being raised today actually lie. Because if you look at the problems of diversity, problems of inclusion, problems of immigration, the capacity of human beings to have multiple personalities at the same time, to live with doubt, all of these things are not actually at this point encouraged by technology. And that's a very important philosophical question as well as an organizational and imaginative problem. We have to go back to thinking about society as a permanent experiment, to the comfort of disorder. And somehow you have to think about technology, communications technology, as being a supporter and a driver of that. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Mikola. I'm working with the ISC project. I'm based in Kyiv, Ukraine, and we are providing long-term support to civil society organizations. So we are working with digital security. Crimea is a half island. It was annexed by Russia 2 years ago. During the last 2 years, situation with human rights in Crimea became worse and worse. And here is the digital security dimension. So under attack, first of all, are Crimean Tatars, their community, their Muslims, human rights defenders, lawyers, lawyers of lawyers. There are some interesting situations, yeah. And journalists. So what incidents are happening? First of all, it's searches and equipment confiscation. They are more prominent, visible. We can see a lot of reports or some news article that, again, some journalist, all of his equipment was taken away, or human rights defender, and so on. And there are two ways of confiscation, a better one and a worse one. A better one was when police or FSB came to someone's office or home and just taking away all the laptops, smartphones, flashcards, and so on. Because if everything is encrypted, then they will not get the information. And the worst way, it's also happening in Crimea, when during the searches, police or FSB is asking to enter your password, and then to log into your email and show to them everything, and log into your Facebook account and show them everything. So this is significantly worse. So anytime you can see that someone was captured by police, for sure there was confiscation of all of his devices. So it's so usual for Crimea. It's you know, every month we can see some cases. The next one is phishing attacks. They are not so visible. We know about them only because we are working with human rights defenders organizations, and they are sending the emails to us and asking what is that? Is it phishing or it's a normal letter? So what is that? So that's why we know about phishing attacks. Usually there are some letters about that unknown phone was linked to your Gmail account, or someone knows your password, or so on, so on. Sometimes it's some link to download a document, a zip file or Word document with some malware inside. Next one is malware attacks. And one prominent case is journalist Nikolai Semena case. His criminal case is full of screenshots of his computer. He said that one time something happened to his computer, and he went to computer service company. And after that, something wrong was going on with his computer. The mouse was moving by itself, and after he was captured by police, they showed him a lot of screenshots of his emails, of his contracts with the media outlets, and so on, so on. So we have one prominent case. Prosecuting for Facebook posts. For example, a lawyer, Emil Kubardinov, a few years ago shared one post, and it was before the Russian jurisdiction came to Crimea, and it was before that organization he shared about became a extremist organization in Russia. But still he was captured for 10 days in prison like that. So prosecuting for Facebook or any social media post is working in Crimea as well. Impersonation. I know one case, again, only because human rights defenders asked for help. So it was activist's account hacked, and guys from FSB was writing messages to his contacts asking for some documents, for some information about another activist, and they was quite successful, actually. And of course, SORM, the Russian mass surveillance system. We don't have any I don't know, cases in media about it. In Crimea, someone got to a jail because of SORM, but we know Russian legislation that any internet service provider or mobile carrier or social network based in Russia have to buy and install some equipment for direct surveillance to get direct access to a local FSB office. The main part actually is over. You can see it's quite simple to explain what incidents are happening there. And if any questions about any of them, I could explain more. And if some questions you want to write me, this is my email. I'm based in Ukraine, and actually, I don't know, I can answer about anything happening in Ukraine in terms of digital security if you are interested. So I have 6 minutes. If there are some questions, I'm ready to yes. Yes. I don't know.
I went to see Crimea Tatars just before the invasion, so I'd be curious to hear a little bit more about their situation now. I know their leaders, I think, have fled to Kiev, I believe, but how specifically does their situation fit into the digital security incidents?
In Crimea.
The Crimean Tatars.
Crimean Tatars. Not all of them went to Kiev, so a lot of them...
I meant just the two or three leaders or a small group of leaders went. Yeah.
So they are staying in Crimea. They are a really strong community. And Russia is trying to, I don't know, trying to make some criminal cases against them. Their community and religious organization became a terrorist organization. And sometimes they came to... come to a village and just to make some searches in a 5-10 houses and take away all the computers. So Crimean Tatars are in bad situation now in Crimea. And of course there is some more discrimination at workplaces and in any sphere of life. Okay, then, thank you.
I'm usually loud enough, so mic is not always necessary. Yeah. So when listening to a previous speaker, just have to say that I'm fortunate to live in Europe, and as well with some of the speakers that are going to be speaking after me, their cases doesn't quite compute with the case that I'll be talking today about. And my name is Alan Durick. I'm a CTO and the co-founder of Wire, but also at the same time, father of a lovely 15-year-old girl. Top of the class, you know, classical teenager girl. And not that long ago, I discovered that she's being followed every day on her way from home to school. Then afterwards, started digging more and see like she's being followed not only on the way to school, she's being followed also when she's visiting her teenage friends. Then you start investigating a little bit more, and then you see that all of her communication that she has with her friends is being intercepted. And then, of course, you freak out. And what do? Are you going to call police? No, because all of this is happening in a digital domain. So then we ask ourselves a question, why something, what is happening in a digital domain, is completely acceptable when we compare it with our daily life? And if we say that you lead by example, some of those leadership cases that I'll show are not the best. Like Mr. Eric Schmidt saying that if you have something to hide, maybe you should not be doing it, or you should not be talking about it. Well, privacy is a paramount in the case when you need to defend your own privacy, when you are being caught up with underage girls or close to underage visiting fancy loft, and then when some of the media like CNET writes about it, then all of the employees of that specific company are not allowed to talk to CNET anymore on anything. Or if you look a little bit further, privacy is not anymore a social norm. Well. Of course it's not when it's my, yours, my daughter's privacy in case. But if it's your own privacy, then you build enough big plot of land to protect your own privacy. And not only in a Silicon Valley, but the same thing is happening also in Hawaii, where there is the someone's summer house. And then, of course, with those cases, when there comes a great power, it's only a question of time when there comes abuse. And here are some of the cases of illegally scanned messages, like in my daughter's case, but of course it didn't go with a lawsuit, but someone else was doing the lawsuit, and manipulating our feelings in a way that only a bad news can be passed to certain people, good news to others. And of course, what's the next step there? It's for those that are getting a bad news, suggest ads from those that are willing to pay the most, and that's pharma industry. And this is nice way to increase the value of every subscriber, because revenue of the advertisements from those companies cannot go any further by total available market, because we are there talking about access to a plus billion people that represent 99% of the wealth on this world. So how you can increase the value, because all those are publicly traded companies, and they need to justify their high valuation and their price earnings ratio is not one or it's not two, three, it's in a double digits. And how you increase that? By digging deeper into our privacy and then selling the stuff that has high margins and where advertisers are willing to pay a lot. Pharma, insurance, all on behalf of our privacy. And then, of course, there comes a question, how far does this go and how far it will go? Do not evil is not a norm or is not what Google is being associated with, unfortunately, for a number of years. They were my idols and they were my favorite company more than a decade ago or close to 2 decades ago. Today, situation is quite different. And then, again, there comes a question, how far this can go and who's watching the watchman? So what we can do in order to make sure that this doesn't go too far? We need to look at the legal perspective, and there is still quite a bit of a discussion about regulating over-the-top applications and players in a way that communication service providers were regulated in the last century. So regulation that is today being imposed on companies that are in OTT space is primarily looking up to, if you look at it from OSI layers, technically speaking, and OSI stands for Open Standards Interconnect, like we have 7 layers there when we are communicating, and first 4 relate to transport, and then first layer is the physical access, and then it goes up to a 7th layer where there is the application. So regulatory and laws need to apply to application, and then there, of course, one of the things what it should be regulated, not on a net neutrality basis, it should be regulated on a privacy that it's giving to its users or taking away from its users. Unfortunately, those laws are slow, but we need to work on them. There needs to be a legal framework there. And then second thing is, also it's good to look into the services that us here as the opinion makers and the ones that our neighbors, friends and family are using as the references. What we are using and that what we are using when it's free, is it free? We all know that most of the times this free can be the most expensive model, but not people that are in our circles. And then one thing that is readily available is encryption. When data is encrypted, at least the content is being protected. And there we need more encrypted communications, we need more products that is using strong encryption, not the other way around, which is unfortunately now being pushed in the light of terrorist attacks and where terrorist attacks are being used to weaken encryption and to weaken our privacy. And then beside protecting the content, there is more there to protect. It's a metadata. And with the metadata, how do we take care of it? Read the privacy policy of the products that you use and that we use. make sure that other people know whenever those privacy policies are not good enough. In my company, we got amazing feedback from users with the stuff that we were not simply aware of. And we have up to now third, fourth iteration in our privacy policy. And what's nice there is it's getting shorter and shorter, and it's getting readable by anyone. So those privacy policies, they need to be written in a language that is understandable by anyone using the service, not only understandable by lawyers, written with a small footprint. And it's us that have there the force and that have the mandate to change those things. As well, try to favor applications that are using open source and that are, in a way, ultimately transparent to you and to us. Things are going to get only worse because we are intersecting Internet of Things, we are intersecting with automotive industry, digital health. So this problem that we have now, it's going to be a magnitude bigger when it gets into all those pores of our life. So what we can do is reclaim ownership of our data, demand transparency for the services you use, use encryption, blunt pitch, try our product, let us know what sucks there, what's good about it. And this is done by people that changed telecoms forever. It is quite some number of people that were involved in Skype that started Skype. Now we are on a mission to change the way that consumers and businesses are communicating from privacy and security point of view. Product, what is important is available on all of the major platforms, and what's even more important, we don't need your mobile number and we don't need your address book. Register with a burner email, use it for the cases that you need, and be safe with it. And all of that is done without taking away fun with the giffies and everything else. So it's not only meant to be done in a dry way. So once more, coming back to the beginning of presentation, digital and everyday privacy, why the difference? There shouldn't be. Let's make sure that we propagate this message and that we do whatever we can to get it to that position. Thank you, everyone.
Hi, good afternoon to all. I'm Martin Borgioli from Hiperderecho. Hiperderecho is a Peruvian non-profit organization that works on the defense of human rights in digital environments. I'm here to present a case of heightened surveillance that is being carried out in Peru. In 2015, the government took advantage of a wave of insecurity to publish some decrees that obviously weren't discussed in the Congress. One of them, for example, coordinate and organize the public CCTV and the private CCTV that is recording public spaces. Another decree, for example, obliges to all the mobile users to register their biometrics data to the ISP. And the one that I will present here is the degree 1182, which is better known as Stoker Law. The Stoker Law has a weird title. It's degree that regulates the use of the information derived from telecommunications for the identification, localization, and geolocalization of communication equipment in the fight against delinquency and organized crime. It's a very long title for a degree, but well, I'm going to bullet point some points of this degree. One of them is that it gives to the police the capacity to request metadata from the users or mobile phones users without a warrant. This request has an ex post revision. When the police requests the information, the police has to request the authorization to the criminal prosecutor, and the prosecutor has to request the authorization to the criminal judge. So the police could have the metadata of you for 72 hours, and then maybe being unauthorized. Also, the decree says that the metadata is not part of the secret of communications that is contemplated in the Constitution. Also, the decree obligates to the ISP to retain your metadata or the metadata of users and to create a database with this data for 36 months. And although it is an obligation and a cost for the ISP to create this database, design a protocol of application between the ISPs and the Ministry of Internal Affairs. They are signing. So we request this protocol, and obviously with a public information request, and obviously they said that it is reserved. So we are in the darkness of what is going on with this degree and with this application. We don't know how the police is working with our metadata. And obviously, it is related to the other's degree, which obligates us to go to the ISP and register our service with biometrics. Well, we took action of this and start promoting a campaign against this decree, which is against the decree, the Decreto Legislativo 1182, as we said. We are doing also some events. Some sensibilization with a parody of the degree, which is the Chapulín Colorado. It's a Mexican soap opera. So and then we are also publishing some academics publications. OAS helped us. Another NGOs from the region and other part of the world help us too, but it is not enough. I'm here also to look to for your help. I'm my contact, and if you wanna know more about what we are doing, this is our pet, Hyperion, and well. Thank you very much for your time.
Well, hi everyone. My name is Michel Olmedo. I'm a Spanish lawyer, so I think that my point of view will be a bit different from the guys that spoke before me. Instead of talking about human rights and privacy and those kinds of issues that relate mostly to private personal data, what I'm here to talk about is about the reuse of information, but from the corporate and personal perspective, rather than instead of closing the law, the data in the background, putting it to good use and do something with the with this data. Let's go. Okay. I represent the UDECO project, that is an H2020 project funded by the European Commission that strives to make a sense of what the data economy in Europe is. Is there actually a data economy? Is there a data to be used? Is there anything to do at all? That's the premise where we started for, and we're trying to see if there is actually some things to be done in this regard. We take a threefold analysis. We say, okay, what is the law in this regard? What do we regulate? Do we have a law for private information? Yeah, but do we have a law for corporate information? Yeah, well, no, maybe. That's the starting point we took. We also take a look at the intellectual property law, which we all know that it's in the mouth of everyone lately due to piracy and other kinds of stuff. Also at trade secrets law, there are many different regulations that take place in the data economy, if there is actually one. We also take a look at the technology. We see if there are any standards that are missing in the European Union that could be implemented in the European Union that perhaps the US is using, but we're not. We started not knowing anything, and now we can see that there are many things being done in this regard. That we may be up to the point, we may not be, but there are things that can be done in this regard. And there are also, I split it in two, but it could be put into one, that is in both economic and societal perspective, and we see what people think about this data economy. We ask both companies and private persons, okay, would you share your information if it weren't your personal information, but just your sales numbers, the track records of your delivery guys, what data that you can provide to these? Would you share it? Why not? Why yes? For what? For what cost? How do you value this data? How do you value the acquisition of that data when it's aggregated with a lot of different data sets that provides you with more value? So, to sum up, what we look is there actually a big data favorable environment in Europe? So that's what we are trying to do at the moment. The consortium is formed by five companies. Reuters is a Spanish consultancy firm, which I represent. We also have University of Leiden giving us a hand with the legal section and the socioeconomic section. We have Fraunhofer from Germany and the Scora from Germany as well, who take a look at the technological and socioeconomic perspectives. And we have IVS Set, who is from Hungary, and they take mostly care of dissemination of this project. So you can see that it's quite an heterogeneous group. Okay. As I said, we started with a framework analysis. We took a look at what had been done up until this moment. We took a look at, okay, what is the law? What are the current legal projects that are being carried out in this regard? What are the current investment trends in regards of technology? Which technologies are companies investing on? Which are they disregarding? Why? And also, how are other H2020 projects dealing with data? Because H2020 projects, as you know, tend to interrelate actors from many countries, so seeing how they shared or they didn't share the data was also very interesting for us. That was part of the first year of our testing. Then we said, okay, now we have to create a model of how this looks, how this works, how this is. And we created, well, not actually a model like a playing car or anything, but we created a set of recommendations and propositions for both actors and policymakers to take a look and say, okay, here is where you're failing, here where you're good at, here is what you should take a look at. And now I'm going to tell you a little bit from the legal perspective. Sorry if you're here to hear something from the technological side. Here, if we were to represent the data economy as we can see it up to this moment, it would be something like this. There are millions of interrelations between data owners, data processors, data users, data reusers, and a lot of freeloaders who just sit there and enjoy the ride. But as you can see, it's not on just one direction. There are multi-directional relationships. There are not only one-sided, because there are many companies who can be data users, but they could be also data processors. So they have many interests, and they have many information to provide us with in both the legal, the technological, and the socioeconomic perspectives. And this one over here. We started with propositions, because we couldn't just go on and say, okay, here's what we want you to do. We started saying, okay, how are we? The first thing we saw is that data protection law was clear, okay, on how to deal with personal data. But we had nothing to work on relating to corporate data. We could maybe bring something from trade secrets directives, something like that, but we didn't have a law on corporate information. We didn't have a clear framework in this regard. So many companies just said, okay, I could do things, but maybe I won't. Maybe I won't, because I don't know what may happen to me should I do anything in this regard. From that on, we also found out that cybersecurity is a threat to this value chain, because it creates a fragmentation. You tend to be as secure as possible, but can you actually keep up to the task? Because standards and technology change in the blink of an eye. So if you have to keep up to date and then also reuse this information, how can you be sure that the data is secure? Many companies just disregard reusing and using data because they say, okay, should I turn all these papers that I have here filled with data into something digital? It's too scary. It's too scary for me. So no, let's just keep it in the back door. Yeah. So they say that it's better for them, instead of profiting and getting some revenue from this, to just keep the data stored, taking a lot of dust in the back door. There is also a lack of standardization. We see that not only between countries, there are also many different sectors in economy that disregard the standardization because they say, okay, I would like to keep my information for myself, because I'm not going to share it with anyone. I'm just digitizing it because it's easier for me to check, but I don't want to share it with anyone. So they create their own standards, and so when other actors try to get use of that information, say, okay, I can't. There's no interoperability for me to work on. And there are many efforts in some little sectors to create some homogenization in this regard and create some standards for this information, but so far, and when we started with this project, there was no real intention in this line. Emerging technologies are also a problem because due to how European law is conceived, it tends to be updated regularly. If you take a look at copyright law, you can say that it was just updated 16 years ago, and it's a new reform coming our way right now. Whereas if you take a look at similar laws in the national side, you can see laws from the 1800s, the 1900s, and they're not going to be touched in another 100 years. So in the European perspective, we tend to change laws quite regularly. There are cybersecurity and e-privacy directives coming our way real soon. So we are facing a status of unknowing what may come soon. Also, due to social media and similar initiatives taking place right now all around the world, users are, instead of just consuming data, they also produce a lot of data. All those smartwatches and everything you have, you can't even imagine how much data you store in just a walk from here to the lobby. The ownership of data is also one thing that creates a lot of problems, because people think, okay, if there's some data online, I can use it. Well, no. Just because you can access something doesn't mean that you can use it. There are licenses, contracts, and a lot of stuff that may allow you to do some things, but not others. And that's another key point of why many people are discouraged on getting on board with the data economy. And also, taking, for example, Russia, that passed a law in this regard quite recently. There are some countries that are imposing data localization directives. You know that would mean that every data has to be stored in their borders, within their borders. Should every country take this approach? How can you create a data economy when the data of each national has to be in each country and you can't really play with that data? You can do anything with that data, regardless of how strongly you anonymize it or how you work with it. And then from there, we reduced it into just six very simple recommendations, split it between if they were for policymakers or the agents of the data economy. There has to be a clear efforts in this digital section. We have to make use of the opportunity that now there are so many open initiatives in the regulation of the digital area. We have to keep them on and we have to finish them as soon as possible. So as soon as possible, the digital economy can take shape in Europe. We also saw that the status of platforms should be clarified because there's not a clear standard in this regard otherwise. As well as I mentioned before, the ownership of industry data is also a key point of here. For the agents, we also saw that using SEALs certifications and in this regard standards is something that it's, as I said, starting to take a little bit of form, but it's not really up to the task at this moment. There are some sectorial advances, but we need something more unanimous. We need some push to the digital economy as a whole. We also saw that there are so many agreements and so many contracts and so many legal guardian between everyone that just discourages people from getting into the digital economy. So we are trying to let people know that there are many more simple ways to do this. You can have licenses that are open. You saw the Creative Commons that our friend had on his presentation just a while ago. It would be easier ways to do this, but many companies are, as you know, discouraged from doing so. And we have to take advantage of the quite good, even though really much criticated GDPR. It creates a great framework to start working on this digital economy. So it is the moment now to do something in this regard. These are the questions that we still have to answer. Are companies actually interested in data reuse? We're still not sure. We're concluding our exam next year, our project next year, but we're still not sure if they're actually interested because there are many companies that are, but there are so many others that clearly aren't. There are many barriers that we found, but maybe there are even more that we still haven't encountered because the analysis is not finished, as I said. Also, we have a strong impression that it may be, but we're still getting information from many companies regarding if it's beneficial for them actually to do so. If the problem that it creates for them to digitize and open their databases may be even worse for them, they should say so if they saw that as a problem. We also are quite certain, so this box shouldn't be here anymore, but we are quite certain that it's not the clearest framework of them all, but there are workings in this regard. We're trying to make the law as human as possible, not just something for us devils to use. Also, we can say that Europe is actually keeping up with technology. We are not so much as an underdog as we used to be, where there are so many projects that are being carried out between the H2020, FP7, and many other initiatives of the European Union that are making this digital economy take real shape. And the last question that is the key one is the EU ready to foster this data environment? This is all I had to tell you. I see that no one fell asleep, that's good for me. And you can check anything else that you may find interesting on any of our social media and websites, or if you have any questions, please feel free to ask. I say no, okay.